Okay, thank you. It's nice to have a presentation after this nice presentation of the practice in Cornell University, because what I plan to talk, to discuss with you, has a big relationship with the presentation you happened to hear a few minutes ago. DANS is a rather new institute in the Netherlands. It has been founded in 2005 and is a special construction in the Netherlands because it has two organizations that will fund this institution. It's the Royal Netherlands Academy of Sciences and the National Organization for Scientific Research, NWO. It has two major points. It started just as an organization to archive data sets, but it has been developed. It has developed during the last few years, and now it's also busy with setting up research policy, data research policies, and training and outreach for data set to have contact with researchers to make them believe that it is very good for them and for the society as a whole to share their data. Well, the last thing I said, there's also, I have some leaflets here, I come back to it later, but it's also related to the presentation you heard earlier. The data seal of approval and a major one that is on European settlement for giving trust to data sets, because that's one difficulty. Well, you putting data into a repository, can you trust him as a researcher? I'll come to this later on. Within the Netherlands, DANS is also known as a service provider for services like Narcissus. Maybe you've heard of it. It's a portal giving access to publications, research data, and to research projects. EASY is the data depositing function, and the National Resolver, I will explain later on, is for the, also mentioned earlier, the giving sustainable access to data using persistent identifiers. When we saw those, what was it called? The loon, I think it was. yeah. Well, I sort of, well, you have all those kinds of stuff without, around the loon, the data, the videos, the beeps of the bird, and of course the publications, and that makes it enhanced publications. Well, enhanced publications. Well, as here you have the data sets, video fragments, images, and so on. And of course, not all those components have to be included into an enhanced publication. So, if you have a loon without an audio fragment, it still isn't, of course, an enhanced publication. But some troubles we have in with this definition of enhanced publication. We also discussed it early on with the within OpenAI Plus. What is an enhanced publication? We have, especially in the Netherlands, huge discussions on the concept of enhanced publications. Especially coming from the field of the data sets, you sometimes have a data set with some information about the project or the funder information, and maybe some extra files with it, but without a publication, a traditional publications. And then I think we can discuss about it, that you also can see that as an enhanced publication. If you have an enhanced publication without these, I don't know if it has some pointer on it, but without a traditional publication, it could be also an enhanced publication. Please be aware of it, because it makes it easier to discuss with researchers. And also, it's relating to the way you are composing enhanced publications. There are two ways, well, in my view, it's my view only, but to compose enhanced publications. First, you have a system that you have, for instance, a traditional publication, a data set, and project description, and they have one field in common. Could be the author, it could be the grant, the grant of European Union, or as we have in Holland, ARFODI. It's a very difficult abbreviation, and I don't know what it stands for, but there's some projects subsidized by ministries, the government in Holland, and then the researcher is obliged to add this ARFODI number in both the project description and the publication and in the data set. Well, that makes it easy to combine them, and I called it then the relationships are unbiased, because it's just on the presence of this field, the author, or this ARFODI number that the relations have been made. Of course, there's another way to, I call it man-made composition, but another way, another term is also good, of course. And then the researcher, it's himself or she will combine the components. It's up to the researcher what components will be added into the enhanced publication. And sometimes it's not clear why this researcher has entered video or text or an image into this enhanced publication. Sometimes they add some information, but it's also occurring that they don't give information to it. So we have two types of enhanced publications. One with quite clear relationships built on existing fields, and one made by persons, researchers, that think, well, this object has a relation with another object. As you see here, you have some terrible example for me. There's two football teams, Denmark and the Netherlands. There's a relation with them. Firstly, I thought, well, it was two images of football teams from small countries that are rather successful in Europe. But of course, now it is, the relation is that Denmark has defeated Holland. So the relationships can shift over time. Then the more technical search, because I was here for especially the technical relationships, although I'm not a very technical person, just a biology, as Inge has introduced. How to describe the relationships in an easy way that also is transferable to other systems? Well, in the Netherlands, we've decided to use OAE Aura. I think some of you have heard of it. Van der Sampel, also used to be from Ghent University, has been a promoter of the Aura system. And it is a very easy model to give the relationships between the different components of enhanced publications. Yes, three levels. The top element is a resource map. This gives the information about the composer of these enhanced publications. So in your example, the professor from the Loons. And the resource map describes the aggregation, and that's another word for the enhanced publications. In the enhanced publications, you see the aggregated resources, and it could be anything. So you have the resource map, the aggregation, and the aggregated resources. And if you set in the Van der Sampel model, as I call it here, then you see here to the left in the yellow one is the resource map, and that describes, of course, the aggregation with different types of elements of this enhanced publication. Well, that's what we've adopted in the Netherlands, and we've started some experiments at Dance for creating and introducing those enhanced publications into systems. This was explained earlier. What is the big advantage of enhanced publications? You have the background information is easy to find. When you say, well, this is the conclusion of our publication, then you have immediately access, hopefully, to the raw data that has been used to draw this conclusion. And Another way to say, well, we are discussing it here, I don't know is how it is with you, but we at Dance, we are thinking about changing the term of enhanced publication into research in context, or information in context. Well, the advantage of this solution is that you don't have the discussion anymore, or if a traditional publication has to be a part of an enhanced publication or not. If you're just speaking about information in context, then you are absolutely free in combining elements in a construction like this without the necessity of adding a traditional publication into the enhanced publication. Well, but I don't know what the development will be, but I think it is a nice discussion to have. And advantage of the man-made publications, well, there are some, but they are also causing troubles, but it's also the case, always the case with things like this. They just, you can combining elements into an enhanced publication, but you also have the possibility to comment on that. And also may comment on their own relationships, but they may also allow other researchers to comment on the components they have brought together. Well, that is of course a dramatic change in the concept of the enhanced publication, because if other persons, other researchers add information to it, then the total composition is changing over time. So the enhanced publication now is another one as the enhanced publication in 2013. So there is a need for a kind of version control of a time back machine or something like that. I know that Van der Sompel has made some progression in it. I forgot the name of it. It's something with time with it to make a change over time or an enhanced publication. So you have a time range of different versions of an enhanced publication. And still, it is not clear, and here is more important, what kind of relations have we made that is also more partly in the mind of those researchers. Then when you have them, you saw it in the Loon example. Well, yes, there was the bird in the center, and then all those things around it. Well, that's one kind of presentation. I think for a start, it could be very good. This is just a textual representation of an enhanced publication. I don't know if everybody can see it, but that is not that important. It's just a presentation with a title and compiler, as we call it, because also composer, the date of composing it, and an abstract of the enhanced publications. But it's quite similar as a presentation of a textual, a traditional publication. So that doesn't make sense to give the value, to present the value of the enhanced publications. On the background, in producing this, we have changed the way you represent them. It's not the way like in text document in HTML, but it's RDF XML serialization of ORA behind it. So you see here, this sentence gives you the actual URL of the resource map, and it's in bold. You see what is described by this special resource map. So to the end, aggregation 561 is the name of the enhanced publication described here. Well, of course, it's not very attractive to a researcher, but it's in here, all the information. It's going further and further, of course. It's just a detail. For really effect on the way researchers will work, then a visualization, of course, is necessary. Let's see, I think I have a smart interruption in my presentation here. Well, I just explained here, I already explained this, the major terms of dance already. I thought I had a presentation on the baby. No, that's. I think the visualization is in the presentation, but otherwise I'll tell it. Is it not? Well, important is some services we have also in relation with the persistency and the sustained access to a presentation. You need persistent identifiers to the every single component of an enhanced publication. We have easy for in the for dance for the depositing of datasets when a dataset has been offered to. Deposited in DANCE, that it will assign, DANCE will assign to it a persistent identifier. A persistent identifier is of course not enough. You also need a resolver service, a service that will redirect the user that is knowing the persistent identifier of a certain object to the actual URL of that object. Because we've noticed in the Netherlands that sometimes an object has moved from Groningen to Maastricht, two university towns in the Netherlands. So the actual URL of the object has been changed. But if you have the persistent identifier, there's no trouble because the resolver will lead you to the new URL, in this case Maastricht, instead of the old URL in Groningen. So you need also a resolver system when you want to set up a system for enhanced publications with persistent identifiers. Well, I think Narcissus you all well know. I'll skip it because of the time. When we have Narcissus, let's start again. As we have Narcissus at DANCE with access to publications, data sets, and research descriptions, but separate to each other, without relationships to each other, then it would be a good thing to make a development in the Narcissus system that will allow for the presentation, visualization of enhanced publications. So we have cooperated with SURF. In 2011 to realize that for making a start of a better version of enhanced publication in Narcissus. So we have some, well, maybe that is dependent on the country where you are living in, but we have decided to have some strict settlements to start with. For instance, enhanced publications has to be deposited in repositories. Those repositories must be harvestable through the OAI-PMH protocol. And the descriptions of the enhanced publication must be made in OAI ORA, using RDF XML for the serialization of these enhanced publications. And of course, you need a visualization tool to give a nice view on those enhanced publications. And the last condition was the use of persistent identifiers. All these conditions were already available, but it's not the combination that was new for getting the infrastructure for enhanced publications. Well, then you see here a way, I certainly has entered a visualization of the enhanced publication in the presentation. You see an example of it in the Berta version in Narcissus. You see here in the, well, it's called brown gold. You see in the central place the aggregation or the enhanced publications. In this case, with the author is mentioned above, is Mr. Seideman. And around it, you see the other components of the enhanced publication. In this case, to the left, it's just a fragment of the enhanced publication. The conference on the that is related to the enhanced publication. That's a component of it. And the rest, to the right, you see an entrance to the author, when you click on that, you see background information of the author, where he's working, what is with whom is he working, what are his projects, and so on and so on. So doing it this way, you can have a very nice overview of the components of enhanced publications. When you click on one of these components, then that component will be the center of the presentation. So the presentation is changed, is the way you get the enhanced publication presented is dependent on the way on the components you choose to click on. Not only identifiers for objects, persistent identifiers are important, but also identifiers for the authors. We in Holland use the digital author identifiers, it's a typical Dutch solution, but all Dutch universities and the Academy of Sciences work together, assigning unique identifiers to every researcher in the Netherlands. And it is a very nice system because you can add these author identifiers to the project description, to the data set, and to the publication. And that will help to make machine-made enhanced publications because the digital author identifier is always the same. And you see here for the Mr. Seideman has also an digital author identifier 304A329611. 60. So you can also enter this into the Narcissus system and you will come to the total production of Mr. Seideman. Because there is a big disadvantage of this, because it is a Dutch system. So we are now looking for a way to incorporate this digital author identifier in the ORCID system, and then we have an international way of having an author identification that is valuable in all countries in the world. Well, this I've explained here. It is very small here, but the use of the persistent identifiers to objects. You see here the doctoral thesis, and it has an unique persistent identifiers. And we in Holland used at the moment the URN-NBN system. And other preferring DOIs or other persistent identifiers, but that's not very important. It is important that persistent identifiers are being used, and well, it's not bothering me what kind of system for persistent identifier will be used. In summary, the enhanced publication KIF gives you a total new way of disseminating the information, so you have all the things together, so you don't have to search for an hour to find all the information about that bird. It's all related to each other. You can use the already existing infrastructure for repositories and for transferring descriptions of enhanced publications. And the OE or model is a good way to describe those enhanced publications. Then, in short, some remarks on digital preservation data creation, because if you have an enhanced publication, then you need to want to be sure that these components are still be accessible in the future years. For the traditional publication, we have in Holland a system that the National Library is responsible for sustainable access to the publications. For the data sets, we have two things also discussed earlier this morning already, a data management plan and a data seal of approval. In short, the data management plan, I think it will be discussed later on more in detail, but we in advance we say, well, you describe what data you have, what hard software you have used. You must have some settlements for intellectual property rights and legal requirements, and of course describing the reuse of the data. Data seal of approval, I have lifted here, yes, here it is, the data seal of approval. That is a minor system to ensure sustainable access. You have also the ISO standards, and they are very difficult. It costs you a lot of time and money to get a certificate of an ISO standard. But the DSA approval is quite simple. It gives you guidelines for the data producer, the data archive, and the data consumer. And the way it is, the organization itself does the assessment, so it is a self-assessment. Then the board of the data seal of approval comes to your organization and does a peer review, and then the DSA will be as granted or not, of course. But in the guidelines, it says trust is very important. The organization must be trusted. If you put a data archive at Dans, people must be sure that we don't throw this data set away, of course. Open access, seen from a funder. In Netherlands, you have the NWO as a major funder. Also was already busy with open access to research publication, but also to research data now. They have changed their policy. There's now a new rules in the Dutch organization. Very important is that when you're producing data sets with a subsidy, a grant of NWH, then NWH is becoming co-owner of those data. So you are not allowed to do it on yourself, to handle on yourself with those data. No, the funder is the co-owner of these data. And here you see it's considered to be the co-producer of data generated as a result of the grant. Well, by doing this by NWO, there's a very strength. Now, researchers feel the obligations to do something with the data they have produced when they have received a grant from NWO. So this giving a big push to the settlements around data in the Netherlands. Then my last slide, I think that was very important, is that copyright rules, as also discussed earlier, may differ from component to component, but also from country to country, discovering problems. And also when researchers are able to compose enhanced publications, then sometimes they add some obscure objects from Africa into their enhanced publications. And that becomes very difficult to say, well, this whole enhanced publications is sustainable, because you don't have any control of the objects available in the repository in Africa. Well, thank you for your attention. I hope it made some things clear to you.